Good morning. Oh, it was a great way to start the service. I love that song. I don't know about any of you folks that are quite my age or past my age, but that takes me back to when I was a kid. That was beautiful. Hey, so that's a great way to start the service, and we're about to have a baptism now, too. And I just want to share with you guys a story I came across about a baptism service. It says, our three-year-old daughter, Rena, sat with us during the baptismal service last Sunday night, which is a new experience for her. She was surprised. Why did he push that guy in the water? Why, Dad? Why? It says, my wife tried to explain briefly and quietly, but Rena just wouldn't be satisfied. Later that night, we tried to provide an answer that a child's mind could comprehend. We talked about sin and told Rena that when people decide to live for Jesus and, quote, do good, they want everyone to know about it. We then explained that the water symbolizes Jesus' washing people from sin, and when they come out clean, they go on trying to, quote, be good. Rena didn't like that. Rena immediately responded, if he needed to be good, why didn't Pastor Bob just pull his belt off and whoop him? Sounds like some of your grandkids. Well, hey, we don't do any whooping here at this church, but we do have hard sermons, right? That's enough. Man, I'm so glad that you're here at South Park this morning. We do believe in what baptism symbolizes, that Jesus does make us clean. He does wash us from our sins, because it's not about doing good. It's about knowing the one who is good. Amen? All right, so we all join in together as we get to participate in this.
Thank you, Matt. We do have the privilege of being with Columbus Womack in baptism today. Baptism is a symbol. It's a symbol of Jesus' death, and so when we go under the water, it's a picture of that death. And then when you come out of the water, it's a picture of that resurrection. And so Columbus today is telling you this is what he believes, that Jesus died on the cross for his sins, died for him, and rose again. So Columbus, is that what you believe? Do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for you and rose again? And have you chosen to follow him with all of your life?
Yes, sir, I have.
All right. Then I baptize you, Columbus Womack, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ in baptism. You're raised to walk a new kind of life. All right, will you join me in praying for Columbus? Heavenly Father, we thank you for his faith in you, his faith demonstrated in his baptism today. But Lord, we also pray that you will be with him as he continues on this journey, that he will live this new life that you have for him, that he will seek after you and follow you every day of his life. Lord, we look forward to seeing how you will work in and through him in the days and years ahead. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Come on, brother. Thank you. Hope you guys are excited to worship now. Would y'all stand with us? We'll get the words going here in just a second. Y'all join in with us, the song you know. Now's the time to worship.
Oh, come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. And still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose Him now.
Sing that again. One day.
And one day every tongue will confess You are God. One day every knee will bow. And still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose You now. Oh, come, now is the time to worship. And come, now is the time to give Your heart.
Oh, come,
just as You are to worship. As You are before Your God, come, oh come,
worship the Lord, oh come. And we sing praises to our God this morning because of His great name.
And I sing praises to Your name, oh Lord, praises to Your name. Oh Lord, for Your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to Your name. Oh Lord, praises to Your name. Oh Lord, for Your name.
Glory to Him.
I give glory to Your name. Oh Lord, glory to Your name. Oh Lord, for Your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to Your name.
Great is His name.
Oh, for Your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Let's praise His name. Let's give Him a hand of praise this morning. So, church, there's a passage out of Psalm 96 I would love for us to read together. Would y'all join in with me now? It says, ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come into His courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before Him, all the earth.
We're always reminded this time of year we have so much to be grateful for. Amen. The Lord has been good to us despite anything else that happens in life, whatever the circumstances are. He is always on the throne. And this is what we do as a church every Sunday. We come together and do what? We ascribe the glory due His name. Amen. And so when we sing to Him, about his greatness and his mercy and forgiveness over our lives. We can always come to him before his throne, knowing he has open arms for us. Let's sing this chorus together. Give us clean hands.
Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. No, God, let us be a generation that seeks and seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. No, God, let us be a generation that seeks, seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Give us clean hands, give us your heart. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. No, God, let us be a generation that seeks, that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. No, God, let us be a generation that seeks, that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob.
One more time, give us clean hands.
Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling you. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Leave it all behind.
Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah.
Altar.
No, come to
You may be seated. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your great love for us. We thank you because Jesus died on the cross and rose again. We can have life in you. We thank you for caring about what happens in each of our lives each and every day. We thank you for the ways that you have blessed us with a church to surround us, with families, with friends, Lord. And so, Lord, particularly this week, but not only this week, may we be grateful to you and all that you have done and all that you are doing. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have you ever been just going through your day, minding your own business, and all of a sudden you get a text message, and it's in all caps? And you say, "What have I done? Who have I offended? Why is somebody yelling at me?" Right? Because when you get those all caps, it means something. Now, not everybody realizes it means something when they send all caps, but it intensifies whatever emotion you are sending that message for. So it can be something good, right? You could send "happy birthday" in all caps, and it would intensify the joy that you are sending. But even if "how are you" is sent in all caps, it sounds like "how are you?" And you're like, "whoa, whoa, whoa, I mean, what's going on here?" How we talk, how we communicate matters. And written communication has its limits. And so everything it does means something. So this morning, as we look at the end of this letter to the Galatians, we find that Paul basically writes to them in all caps. He's trying to get their attention. He's intensifying his emotion. We read it in Galatians chapter 6, verse 11. "See what large letters I'm writing to you with my own hand." Now, there have been some clever explanations for this, and I guess there's a possibility. One is that Paul had bad eyesight, and so he had to write in large letters to be able to see what he was writing. Another one is that was a way to say Paul had messy handwriting, which if he did, I'm with him on that one. Thank you very much. I can be more like Paul. He tells us to be more like him, right? And so messy handwriting, it's possible. But the overwhelming explanation, the one that most people say this is what Paul is really doing, is that he is writing in large letters because that intensifies what he is writing. He's trying to get his point across to them. He's trying to make sure that they have heard what he has to say. He's going to make an emotional appeal at the end of this letter. And actually, that's what we find in the rest of these verses, is that Paul makes this emotional appeal to them. Please listen to what I've written. So, Galatians chapter 6, verse 12 says, "It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh who would force you to be circumcised, and only in order that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. For even those who are circumcised do not themselves keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised, that they may boast in your flesh. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts for anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. And as for all who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the marks of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers. Amen. And so Paul ends this letter, but if you have read all the other of Paul's letters, does he end a letter like this usually? No, usually he ends his letters with, hey, so-and-so greets you and so-and-so greets you. Make sure you tell somebody who lives in this house hi and the church that meets in this house hi. And it's this friendly greeting at the end, isn't it? Or sometimes he lists things that he's joyful for. Sometimes he lists things that he needs prayer for. Sometimes it's this beautiful doxology, truth about who Jesus is. And he ends his letters in these ways. And that's what you would expect at the end of a letter. Oh, it would be for us kind of like if you got a form letter in the mail, you get those, right? It's addressed to Chad, but obviously the whole letter is not really written to me, right? But at the end, the person knows me, and so they're going to write a little note at the bottom of the page, and they're going to sign something that's going to be a little bit more personal. And for Paul, the letter does apply to everybody. He does have a targeted audience here, but usually he's writing that nice little comment at the bottom of the page in his own hand. Not this time. Paul's like, give me the pen, scribe. I got something else to say to these people. I'm going to make sure they get this point. Paul wants to drive this home. This is crucial to him. So he's going to summarize what he has said up to this point. Sorry, everybody who thought we were already done with circumcision. One last week. I promise we're done. I think this is why Galatians is the least preached of Paul's epistles. It's probably why we try to avoid it most of the time. But thank you for journeying with me through this. So once again, he makes the point. And in verse 15, he might cause us to question a little bit his point, because he said, what does it matter? Circumcision, uncircumcision, neither of those matter. I'm like, well, Paul, you just told us the whole time that these matter. And what Paul's saying, though, is that the procedure doesn't matter. Whether you are or you aren't doesn't matter. What matters to Paul is what? How it's being used, or in this case, abused in the church. Because these outsiders, these opponents are coming in and they are saying you have to be circumcised to be saved. They are adding it on to salvation. And for Paul, that is a problem. Anytime you add anything to Jesus, you're saying Jesus is not enough. And Paul is clearly saying Jesus is enough. Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection is enough. It is all that we need. It is sufficient for our salvation. And so Paul is trying to make sure that they don't get led astray by people who are trying to get them to see that something else is needed. That's why when I meet with somebody like Columbus when they're about to be baptized, I make sure to tell them, baptism isn't what saves you. Baptism is a picture of our salvation. It's a testimony of our salvation. What saves us is what Jesus actually did when he actually died on the cross and rose again. And then when we put our faith and our trust in him and choose to follow him, that's what saves us. That's why I asked Columbus at the beginning, hey, have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? Have you chosen to follow him? Then he can make that testimony to you. And it's important that even on some things like that, that we draw those lines, because we don't need to add anything else to what Jesus has already done. The other thing we find about these opponents that's here in this letter and at the end of this letter is that this circumcision isn't just an act, but it's a symbol of something even greater. And that is keeping the law of the Old Testament. And so he's saying to these opponents, you haven't kept the law. Why are you trying to get others to keep the law? And with that, what they are basically saying is that you need to become Jewish before you can become a Christian. And that's not the case, is it? Jesus just wants all of us to come to him. We just have one family to join. It's not a two-step process here. And we hear all of that, but how many times do we do the same thing sometimes, right? Well, you need to be my kind of Christian. We might do that denominationally. I also see it in some of the same ways that these opponents do it. I've been overseas to quite a few different countries, and it's comforting sometimes to walk into a church overseas, and everything happens the way you expect it to happen. Right, you walk in, there's a song, there's a welcome, there's a couple other songs, there's an offering sometimes, COVID's kind of into that, but whatever. There's an offering in the service, there's a sermon, and all those tunes of all those songs sound familiar. They're American songs translated into different languages. If it wasn't for a different language in a different country, I wouldn't think I was anywhere else than here in America. And what's the problem with that, though? In some ways, that means we've exported not just Christianity. Instead, we've exported American Christianity. Right? That's what these guys are trying to do. They're trying to export Jewish Christianity to those in Galatia. And so we've got to be careful. Not that we can't share some of the things we've learned. I mean, there's some wonderful songs that it's fine for people to sing around the world. There's creative people who've written those songs, and that's wonderful expressions of worship. The line we've got to be careful not to cross is that you have to do it the American way, otherwise it's not the Christian way, right? Because Jesus didn't come to make American Christians. He came to make disciples of all nations. And so I would venture to argue that the more appropriate way for people in West Africa to worship is underneath a mango tree with some drums and an amazing beat. It might make us a little bit out of our comfort zone, but it would be a wonderful expression of their worship to Christ. You see that line. So sometimes we might say, well, we really don't have this world of Galatians in our world, but we can fall under the same temptations that they did. The other thing we find here is Paul's wrapping up this letter. He once again goes to their motivation. He gives them two motivations for their actions, these opponents there in Galatia. The one of those is they are trying to avoid persecution. The other one is that they are trying to find something to boast in. The first one, they are trying to avoid persecution. If you look at these words, who are they trying to avoid persecution for? They're trying to avoid persecution for themselves. The opponents, the ones coming in and teaching, are trying to avoid their own persecution. It's a selfish thing that's happening. And so as they come into Galatia, as they share this message, they don't want to be persecuted. It's not that they don't want the people in Galatia to be persecuted. It's that they themselves don't want to be. And so what are they doing? They are coming into a place where the main people who are persecuting the church are the Jewish people that live in that area. The main part of the persecution is not coming from the Romans, there's some, but the main part of the persecution is coming from the Israelites that live there. And so what these opponents are saying, well, if we move these Christians one step closer to Judaism, then that persecution will start to go away, because they'll see, oh, y'all are inch by inch getting these people to be more like us, and maybe they will ultimately convert to Judaism. And so they are trying to avoid this persecution, and in doing so, they are leading the people further from what God wants, not closer to what God desires. And so God's moved his chosen people from this to the cross of Christ. So what Paul's saying, let's keep moving in the right direction. Let's not go backwards here. And so first, we find that they're trying to avoid persecution. Next, we find that they're trying to boast. They are trying to brag about what they are able to get somebody else to do. And so it's a notch in their belt. But what we find in Christ is that we don't boast in what we can get other people to do we? We don't even boast in our own accomplishments. What do we boast in? We boast in Jesus Christ. And what he has done and what he is currently and continuing to do in this world. That is the only place that we have any room to boast. So it's not this selfish, self-centered, look at me mentality, but it's this selfless, God-centered, look at him mentality that we are supposed to have. So what does Paul say here? He says, far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. There's a breaking point here for Paul. He, when he comes to faith in Jesus Christ, it cuts him off from the world. Jim Elliot puts it this way: he is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Jim Elliot said that when he was 22 years old. I'd say that he was wise beyond his years. He lived his life for Christ as a young man in the church here in America, but then he had a desire to see those who did not know Jesus Christ come to know Jesus Christ. Those who had never even heard about Jesus to have the chance to hear about Jesus. So he moved to Ecuador, and he began to share his faith with different tribes that live there in Ecuador, and spent 3 years among one tribe and began to see that tribe come to know the Lord. Now, there was another tribe down the road, the Alcas, and that wasn't their full name, but nobody knew their name because nobody could have contact with them. And so Alcas meant naked savage, and that's what they were. They had killed many of the people in the tribe that Jim Elliot was trying to reach. Shell Oil had a drilling station there in Ecuador, and the Alcas had just killed some of them. Anybody who came in contact with this group of people were murdered. Actually, they murdered each other. 6 out of 10 adults in that group, which is actually the Wahadani people, and they finally found out their name. 6 out of 10 adults died from homicide among them. They were a mean, vicious people. So when Jim Elliot encountered these stories, you know what he did? He said, there's only one thing that's going to change them. Jesus Christ is the only thing that will change them. They need to hear about Jesus. So Nate Saint took him, and they flew, and they made visual contact with the Wahadani people. They lowered stuff down in a basket. At some point, the Wahadani put new things in the basket. They were exchanging. They were making these friendly gestures towards each other. They learned some of the language so they could yell down friendly phrases to them. But it came a point where they said, we've got to finally go and meet them. We need to go and start to share this good news with them. So Nate Saint, Jim, or Ed McCauley, Roger, I'm going to get his last name wrong, sorry, Yoderin, and Pete Fleming, along with Nate Saint, all went down to be among the Wahadani people. And they made some friendly contact with them. But after a few days, a warring party of 10 came with their spears and murdered each one of them. He is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. His perspective changed because of Jesus Christ. And it wasn't just a clever saying, it's how he lived and gave his life. That's not the end of the story, is it? Because within 2 years, Jim Elliot's wife, Elizabeth Elliot, Nate Sate's sister, went and lived among the Wahadani people. And they came and put their faith in Jesus Christ. And their whole culture changed. You see, Jim knew what they needed. And he was a step into them getting it. But ultimately, God worked to bring the Wahadani to him. And they were no longer this murderous, hateful people, but a loving, joyful, Christ-filled people. What does Paul say here ultimately matters? Verse 15, neither circumcision counts for anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. New creation is what ultimately counts. God is doing something new in us. He is changing us. He is transforming us. That's what God wants. That's what ultimately matters. It's what we say when we do a baptism, isn't it? Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Says, we are buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too may walk in newness of life. That's what God wants for us. He wants a new kind of life for us, and not the same anymore. So the story is told of a businessman in London who's trying to sell his warehouse. And it's been on sale for a while, and so people have come by, and they've thrown rocks at the windows, and they've spray-painted the walls, and it's kind of worn down a little bit. It's no longer the warehouse it used to be. And so as he shows that warehouse, he tells the potential buyer, don't worry, I'll get the windows fixed before we sell it. I'll make sure it gets a fresh coat of paint. We'll clean the place up. We'll make sure there's nothing wrong with it. But the buyer says, no, don't worry about all that. I'm coming to do something new here. I'm going to just tear it down and build something new. Just leave it the way it is. And I've got something new coming. And that's what Jesus has done for us. He takes the old self and he takes that away and he's got something new for us, a new self for us. So just like the Wahadani became new people, he wants to make us new people, people that look more like him. That have the characteristics that only he can bring in our lives. He wants transformation for us. And that's what ultimately matters. That is the goal here, is that we are new in Jesus Christ. The old is gone and the new has come. And that's what we look forward to, isn't it? At the end, that's ultimately what God is going to do. We will not be the same anymore, but we will be made new. Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I saw a holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Isn't that what we're looking forward to? Isn't that what we ultimately want? Where God comes and makes all of this new. It's not the same anymore. And we get to be with him forever. And that's what Paul's pointing us to. He's saying this is the goal. This is what we're looking forward to. Don't get distracted by other things along the way, but make sure we are headed towards what God desires. It's what he is doing new in our life that ultimately matters. And that next verse, verse 16, he says, and for all those who walk by this rule. And that word rule is a word for standard. It's the thing that we measure up against. And so we don't measure up against the things that we do, whether we follow the right rules in law. The thing that ultimately matters is, has God done something new in your life? Has he made you new? That's what matters. That's what the measuring line is. And if he has, if we put our faith in Jesus Christ and let him transform our lives, then the good news is peace and mercy come. Later, he'll add grace to that as well. So we get peace in our life. Shalom, things made right again. Things made whole again. Mercy, we don't get what we deserve. Grace, we get what we don't deserve. That's what God has in store for us. He wants to do good things in our lives. After Paul has kind of given us this much more positive view of who God is and what he desires, he comes back again. He basically says, y'all quit giving me trouble. Now you're coming back to those opponents once more. And he's really showing how he is opposite of them. Don't give me any more trouble, because I bear on my body the marks of Jesus Christ. And so what they had wanted was to avoid persecution. What they had wanted is people to follow rules and laws and regulations, and they wanted marks on a body. But what Paul is ultimately saying here is what I bear on my body is what I get from following after Jesus. And there in Galatia, when he first took the gospel to them, what did Paul get? He got stones thrown at him. He got dragged out of the city because they thought he was dead. They thought they had done away with him, taken care of him for good. Paul didn't avoid persecution. Paul took on persecution because he knew he had a gospel that people needed to hear. And just like Jim Elliot, he was willing to give up everything for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul's saying that's what ultimately matters. So live this selfless life. That in the midst of a world that might want us to give in the midst of the world that might want us to just go along with the flow, and in the midst of possibly even a voice within Christendom that says we need to be relevant, so we need to find ways to capitulate to the culture, we have a Paul that says we are relevant. We don't need to capitulate because we have Jesus Christ, and that's what this world ultimately needs. That's what we all need. So you are a new creation. And we live among a world that desperately needs to be changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. So in a world that has plenty of other messages that they want us to proclaim, let's make sure we go out and proclaim the message that says Jesus is Lord. Can you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love for us. No, we thank you for your grace that we do not deserve. We thank you for this reminder through Paul's letter to the Galatians that you are enough for us. So Lord, may we find our joy, may we find our peace, may we find you. And Lord, may we live not in this world the way that we want to live or the way others want us to live, but Lord, may we live in this world the way that you want us to live. May we be a transformed people, and may we go out so that we can see the people around us changed by your love and your forgiveness. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us at South Park Baptist Church today. We're so glad you worshiped with us online. If you need to respond in any way to what God's doing in your heart and your life, we'd love to talk to you more about that. If you want to know more about what it means to believe in Jesus, for him to make you completely new, or if you're looking for a church to be a part of, please call me at 281-331-3902, or you can email me at chad@southparkchurch.com. .net. I'd love to talk to you more about what God's doing in your life. We've got a few announcements this week. It's Thanksgiving this week, and so we will not have our regular Wednesday night activities for children, youth, or adults. The following week, children and youth will start back again. For adults, though, we will have our budget discussion. And so that's Wednesday, December the 1st at 6 o'clock here in the Worship Center. We will have our budget discussion for next year's budget. So if you'd like to talk about that, please plan on being here for that meeting. Then we will vote on that budget the following Sunday, December the 5th. We are also currently collecting food for the Alvin Food Pantry. We're collecting warm clothing for those who are in our homeless population that need warm clothing as the temperatures begin to drop. And so if you would like to bring either of those, you can bring them to the church office or to the foyer. This week, the church office will only be open on Monday and Tuesday. So bring it one of those 2 days if you bring it this week. Now, as we go, let me leave you once again with the benediction we find at the end of Galatians. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers and sisters. Amen.
your kindly rule has shattered and broken the curse of sin's tyranny. My life is hidden beneath heaven's shadow. Your crimson flood covers me. Your crimson flood covers me. Glory, glory. We have no other king but Jesus, Lord of all. We raise the anthem. Our loudest praises ring. We crown him Lord.